Welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, we have a few more people. And again, thank you for sitting in the front. I'm going to be preaching some on sin, so I need to have somebody to point at. Yeah, okay, good. Wouldn't point at you because you're wearing pink as well. You got the memo. Let's stand up, but let's not move around because we got a lot going on in the service. So let's stand up and let's greet the people around you. And if you want to wave, you see somebody on the other side, you can sort of wave at them. So let's greet one another in the name of Christ. Thank you. And I like that ending. Boom. Well, again, welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, and everybody who is visiting, welcome. I'm glad you're with us this morning. Just out of curiosity, how many of you are wearing pink? Just raise your hand. Give yourself a round of applause. Okay, very good. One of the things that before we get started, I want to share with you is I cannot look more Southern than I do this morning. Well, Cass is close. But I feel like I'm going to a Matlock convention later. But I will tell you there's just a tiny little story about the seersucker suit. When I was in Weirton, West Virginia, my best friend, probably the best friend I ever had, since I was 18, he wore a seersucker suit. And I thought, whoa, on Easter. I said, whoa, that looks pretty good. And he said, yeah, it is. And so by gum, I got me a seersucker suit. And so we would wear the seersucker suits together on Easter. So that kind of, I have brought this Weirton tradition up. So that's a little story of the suit. Again, welcome in the name of Christ. We've got a lot of things, so I want to... Oh, and y'all who are streaming in, welcome. Glad you're with us. And we got people in the balcony, and they're waving. Why don't you turn around and wave to them? Because we want to make them feel, you know, there we go. Every now and then, say something really loud. I'll assume it's God talking to me. Okay, we got some announcements. Of course, after Easter, everything kind of settles down. But we will be starting a new Bible study series on March. Thank you. We're past that. This next week, we're going to be looking at the Gospel of John. This will be Wednesday at 10:30. If you're available, interested to come, we'll be doing that. So come on to the church 10:30 in the morning. I think you'll find it helpful. Next Sunday, we're going to start a new series. A post-Easter series. Hi. You look chill. That's going to be me, you know, in about 3 hours. We're going to start a new series, Good News for a Change, and it's going to be how the resurrection can change us in different ways. And so I think the outline is in the bulletin. That's what we're going to be doing during the Easter season right up to Pentecost in May. Any other, now there's, I know. One of the things that I think is really, really cool, we're going to have a baptism later. And one of the things that I think is really cool here, and I've never done this before, but I think it's neat, is, and y'all don't know that, maybe you do, I don't know, but you're going to get a shawl. Rosalind, you're going to get this like a little blanket. You realize that? And what we do, evidently what y'all do, and I think this is great, is going to pass it around and you say a little prayer over it. Now, understand, we get the baptism early in the service. So the prayers can't be real long. And I know some of you guys, you know, I'm not going to identify any in particular. Van. No, not Van. You know, you cannot extend the prayer into the sermon. And nor can you use a prayer as an excuse for closing your eyes and dozing a little bit later. So I'll start it here with the beheaded woman. And so we can start and just pass it around and say a little blessing prayer. Are there any other announcements that, nonsense, if you're interested in nonsense, let us know. We'll be taking that trip early. The first day is May 1st, right? And there's information in the bulletin on that. Any other announcements anybody here might have? Yes, Ian. Good. Ian, you did eat all the cookies, though. Okay, good. Because 12-year-old cookies, you know, unless they're Oreos, probably aren't going to do very well. Thank you. Any other announcements? Then, brothers and sisters, as God's people, let's worship Him together. With that in mind, let's all stand and let's sing. Christ the Lord is risen today. It'll be up on the screen. Very good. Y'all may be seated. And would young people come on up front? If you would you come on up front? Excellent, excellent, excellent. Now, what I want you to do this morning, and you did exactly the right thing. I want you to sit right there. Well, no, you can sit there. I'm good. You go have a seat. And Ian and Dana, would you come on up? We are going to do something really, really special today. Because y'all come on up and have a seat. We are going to have and you're going to play, yeah? And what's that?
Can I tell you a joke?
Can you tell me a joke? Yes, I'd love to hear your joke. Tell me your joke.
Why did the Easter egg hide?
Why did the Easter egg hide? Why did the Easter egg hide? Did you get it? Oh, you have a joke? Okay. Very good joke. Very good joke. Do you mind if I steal it?
My Easter buddy put it on our paper this morning.
Oh, I appreciate it. Hey, I have a joke, and then you can do yours. About this is Easter. What do you call a line of bunnies jumping backwards? What do you call a line of bunnies jumping backwards?
Hip-hop.
A receding hairline.
That's good.
Yeah, that was a good one. Yeah, I thought so too. And you know, oddly appropriate when you think about it. Okay, we'll do two more and then because we had something really, really important to do. What's your joke?
What did the egg say to the clown?
What did the egg say to the clown? I don't know. What did the egg say? You crack me up. Yes, and.
So one day I was riding my bike with my dad, and my dad said it was going to be hard to ride my bike in the wind, and I said it was going to be a breeze.
Oh, you were riding your bike with your dad. He said it would be hard to ride in the wind. And you gave the perfect answer, which was, it'll be a breeze. May I steal your jokes? Okay, good, good, good. I won't give you credit, though, because I'll just use them. Okay, well, we're going to have a baptism. You know what we do when we have a baptism? What we do when we have a baptism, when we baptize, and it has water, involves water. No, nobody falls into the water. No, there'd be no water falling here. But what happens is people become part of the church when they get baptized. And our friend here, Robin, is going to be baptized, and those fine, upstanding young people over there are going to be baptized. So what I want you to do as we do the baptism, I want you to look at what we do, okay? Okay, so you can either stand there, or you can sit down, any place that you're comfortable with. What's that? What's that? That was very dramatic, by the way, Grayson. Oh, you're going to stand. Okay, well, standing is also good. So would y'all come on up? And, oh, no, not y'all. y'all can be there on the floor. Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. I've been given all authority on heaven and on earth. Go to the people of all nations and make them my disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit and teach them to do everything I have told you, and I will be with you always, even until the end of the world. Do you want to go stand by your mom and dad? Okay, good. Outstanding. When we baptize those who have been called by Christ, we're obeying his command to us, and we're sure of his presence with us. By his mercy, God's forgiven our sins, joined us together into the body of his Son, which is the church. Through his grace, he delivers us from darkness, leads us to his kingdom. You see, because he loves us, God has promised to be our Father and to welcome us as brothers and sisters of Christ. Baptism is a concrete sign of God's mercy, grace, and love. By baptism, an act that we can never earn and that we can never deserve, God gives us a new identity as his child and a new family called the church. He puts his sign on us to show that we belong to him, and he offers us the opportunity to join with our Christian brothers and sisters to do the work we've been called to do. Ian and Dana, in presenting Rosalind and William and Vivian for baptism, you announce your faith in Jesus Christ, show that you want them to study him, to know him, and to love him, and to serve him as his chosen disciples. Show your purpose by answering these questions. Do you claim Christ's covenant promises on your children's behalf, and do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for their salvation as you do your own? Good. Do you now unreservedly promise in humble reliance upon God's grace to set before them an example of the new life in Christ? Good. Do you promise to pray with and for them and to bring them up in the knowledge and love of God? Good. Outstanding. And I'll tell you, Vivian is really happy. That's always nice. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, we thank you for all your faithfulness that you show us throughout our lives. And we thank you particularly for that faithfulness promised in this sacrament and for the hope we have in your Son, Jesus Christ. As we baptize with water, Lord, baptize us with your Holy Spirit so that what we say may be your word and what we do may be your work. By your power, may we be made one with Christ our Lord, sharing a common faith and purpose. O God, who called us from death to life, we give ourselves to you. And with the church throughout all ages, we thank you for your saving love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen. Now, Rosalind, come over here. And what is her full name?
Rosalind Renee.
Rosalind Renee. I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. That was good, wasn't it? And I'll take the one that's smiling first. And what's her full name?
Vivian
Luann. Vivian Luann. I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Won't be long. Your mom and dad are right there. And his name?
William Thomas.
I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. See, that's what baptism is. Through his grace, God has made us participants as his servants. Rosalind, William, and Vivian are now received into the Holy Catholic Church. See what love the Father has given us that we should be called the children of God, and we are. Be filled with gratitude. Let the message of Christ dwell among you in all its richness. Whatever you're doing, whether you speak or act, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. You are no longer aliens, but are now citizens with God's people, members of God's household. You are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, and Christ himself is the foundation stone. In him, you too are being built with the rest into a spiritual dwelling of God. Thank you. And thank you. Yes. Hey, let me ask you guys, that was baptism. See, that was baptism. What part did you find interesting? The fact that I put water on their head. That's kind of interesting. Yeah, that's because that's what happened with Jesus, and that's what Jesus told us to do, to baptize one another. Hey, now, we got a special, I'm glad you're back. We got a special treat. One of you is going to be playing...
Piano.
So what we're going to do is together we're going to go on that side, you know, right over here. So come on over. And Grayson, assume the position. And you can sit on the floor. Let's sit on the floor right here so we can hear. And Rosalind, you can come over here. And we can sit on the floor and we can listen to. And what are you playing, Grayson? I've got peace like a river. Outstanding. Outstanding. Good job. Come on over. All right, gather around. Okay. And you guys know what I'm going to say. You have a great week. Have a great week. And what do I want you to remember all week? For God loves us. Now, I want you to have a wonderful week. And what do I want you to remember all week long?
God loves us. Happy Easter.
Yes. Hey, Grayson. We come now to the part of the service. Oh, man, I didn't give you stuff to color, did I? I didn't carry it with me. Here. I know you want four. We got to make sure we have enough. Wait, everybody's got to have one. Got to give one. Okay. Well, I'm going to give you some more. Everybody got something? Okay, here. I feel this is like I'm throwing them in the air. Just take as many as you want. You don't want any. Here. Take the rest. Enjoy. Give them to friends, family. That's good stuff. It looks like a feeding frenzy over here. Are we out of stuff? Oh, okay. Hey, we got one crayon left. You want a crayon, Rosalind? Here. Here. Okay? Good. Now, we come to the part of the service when we have the opportunity to lift our prayers to God. When we have the opportunity to lift our prayers to God, are there any particular needs or concerns that anybody here might have this morning? Yes.
Yes, I just wanted to let you know that Ron Lurch, there's planning on him coming home on Tuesday, and so that's a great joy. Hopefully it's going to happen because they're both ready to stay home. And happy Easter to everyone.
Absolutely. We've been praying for Brother Ron. Hopefully he'll be home this week, as Carla is home, which is also great, great news. Any other prayer needs we want to remember into the next week?
We lost a dear friend this past week, Gus Oakley, and he was Bill's dental professor, and then he became a good friend, and he was our travel companion. So prayers for the Oakley family.
We want to remember the Oakley family in our prayers, so thank you.
Just the good news that my brother-in-law Joel made it home, and he is home, and thanks all of you for your prayers and your cards.
How's his spirits?
So he's delighted and adjusting to a new reality.
Good. Then that can be our prayer, that we pray that he adjusts to a new reality. Any other needs or concerns we might want to remember?
Yeah, this Friday I had found out my stepfather had passed away of health complications.
Oh. So we want to pray for
Ted Price.
Yes. We want to pray for the family, yes. Everybody. And you, Cecil. We want to lift you up in our prayers. Also, traveling mercies as you head back to Norfolk. We want to lift those y'all up in prayer. Anything else? Well, then let's go to God now in prayer, and I'll open. And we'll pray for a little bit. Now, part of the prayer will be confession, because we're going to hear God's word in just a little bit. And then you all will have the opportunity to lift your prayers to God, and we'll close by praying the Lord's Prayer together. So let's go before God now in prayer. Lord God, before we say anything else, we got to thank you for giving us this wonderful day to celebrate your resurrection, my goodness gracious. A sign of not only your power and authority, but also a sign of your love. Lord, there's something, though, as we prepare ourselves to hear your word read, there's something we need to confess. Although Easter is sort of part of the fabric of who we are, sometimes we don't use Easter as a way to remember. Easter becomes one of those days that we celebrate, but we don't carry with us. Because we don't use it as a way to grow in our faith, in our understanding, in our knowledge, in our awareness. And when Easter becomes this resurrection event, becomes an isolated event, it doesn't have the same meaning and import it could have if we carried it with us. And so we ask for your forgiveness when we move past Easter and kind of leave it behind. And that we also ask that you help us to remember the meaning of this incredibly important event, the hinge on which human history turns. Help us to remember it, help us to claim it, and help us to grow as a result of it. We ask in the name of Christ. And now in the privacy of our own hearts, we're going to lift up to you the concerns that we heard shared. We're going to lift up to you those needs that are in the bulletin, and we're going to lift up to you all those things that weigh heavy on our heart. Lord God, hear us now as we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for listening to us, and thank you for loving us as much as you do. But right now, thank you for forgiving us, and we know that we've been forgiven. That's what you promised. And also thank you for responding to our needs, and we believe you will do that too. Because we've lifted these needs up in the name of Christ, our Savior, who taught us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you so much. I'll tell you that your singing was wonderful, was really nice. And sitting here, and y'all couldn't see it, Melody, I that was enthusiastic, you know, when you're directing. And in fact, when they hit a high note, you went like this. You reached for it too. That's outstanding. Just out of curiosity, are the prayer shawls still going around? They're back here. Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that. It suddenly hit me that I hadn't seen them sort of land for a while. Our scripture lesson comes from the gospel according to Luke, beginning with the 24th. It's the 24th chapter, beginning with the first verse. Of course, this is a resurrection story in Luke. It'll be up on the screen. If you got your own Bibles with you, I encourage you to read along. Hear now the word of God as written by the evangelist Luke. Early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, carrying the spices they had prepared. When they found the stone rolled away from the entrance, they went in. But they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus, and they did not know what to think. Suddenly, two men in shining white clothes stood beside them. The women were afraid and bowed to the ground. But the men said, "Why are you looking in a place of the dead for someone who is alive? Jesus isn't here. He's been risen from death. He's been raised from death. Remember that while he was still in Galilee, he told you, 'The Son of Man will be handed over to sinners who will nail him to a cross, but 3 days later, he will rise to life.'" Then they remembered what Jesus said. Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and some other women were the ones who had gone to the tomb. When they returned, they told the 11 apostles and the others what had happened. The apostles thought it was all nonsense, and they would not believe. But Peter ran to the tomb, and when he stooped down and looked in, he saw only the burial clothes. Then he returned, wondering what had happened. Amen. Praise God for this reading from his word. Let's have just a brief word of prayer together. Almighty God, inspire us now that the words we've heard and the words we're about to hear, that they may make a difference. In the name of Christ, we pray, amen. Well, here we are on Easter Sunday. Man, we had a baptism. A choir has sung. We're going to do communion later. And you know, even though it was kind of damp yesterday, and I don't know about you, but nothing makes me think about Easter like seeing snow in the air. Today is still a wonderful day because we are here to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, God's Son and our Savior. And I'll tell you, the temperature outside, which is a little, what would you call the temperature outside?
Brisk.
What's that?
Brisk.
Brisk. That's good. Brisk isn't going to interfere with it being warm inside, right? And you know, I think it's kind of interesting. Like a lot of other holidays we celebrate, special days we celebrate during the year, Easter brings up all kinds of memories. At least it does for me. What about y'all? All kinds of memories. And I'm talking mainly to people that have reached a certain point in their lives. You know, that you have memories about this stuff. I mean, when I close my eyes, I can almost see the way it was in the mid-90s when I was a child. Oh, yeah. You do the math.
Thank you.
And you're a dentist.
And you're doing math.
No, back in the 60s, I remember, I could close my eyes. You see, back in the Rüdiger house, Easter meant doing certain things in a certain order. We had traditions at the Rüdiger house. For example, after we got up, my sister, brother, and I, we got our Easter baskets, exactly, that always included this really exotic egg that had our names written on it, but that only Dad would eat, and he ate all three of them. And we'd have each of us would have this great big Easter chocolate, Easter rabbit, you know, that my brother would finish off before we ate dinner. We got all these Easter pictures of this earless rabbit in my brother's. And then he'd start on mine. It was awful. Of course, we'd have those marshmallow peeps, right? Marshmallow peeps, always chicks, always yellow, because that's the way God intends. And of course, all these jelly beans, which are great because they get stuck in the fake straw. Oh, yeah, it's really nasty eating them later. And so we get our Easter baskets, and right after we got our Easter baskets, we would all go and do what? What do you think we would do after the Easter baskets? We would get ready for church. And getting ready for church meant putting on our Easter outfits, and I'm talking about some really spiffy 3X that we had never worn before, which was important to me because that means I didn't have a bunch of these iron-on patches around my knees. And ladies, and I'm only speaking to the ladies, I don't want you to get overly excited, but on Easter, I looked good. I looked good. Man, Mom would plaster down my blonde hair with my dad's Brill cream. Okay? And I would put on my seersucker jacket, and I had a bow tie. I was styling. And my sister, she'd have on this frilly dress and those little socks, those ankle socks that had lace, you know what I'm talking about, that had lace around the top, you know? And I'll tell you, she was rocking the kind of look you only get when you take little bits of hair and wrap them, kind of twist, and wrap them in toilet paper, curl them, and secure them with a bobby pin. Yeah, she looked good too. And my little brother, see, I was the oldest. My little brother, you know, the guy who was eating the chocolate Easter bunny, he looked okay. If you could get past the chocolate Easter residue on his jumper. And so after we've got our baskets, we've changed, Mom and Dad would head us into the front yard. And I'll tell you, this was back in Virginia, back in Norfolk. And back in Norfolk around Easter, you got the creeping phlox, and you got the dogwoods, and you got the azaleas all in bloom. And then while we were out front, my grandparents, those were the Rudigers, not the McLannans, my grandmother and granddad Rudiger would come by in their Cadillac. They were. And I'm talking about the Cadillac with the fins, the big fins. Oh, man, it was good. And then, this may have been the best part, as we were out there, they come out and they take our picture with their Polaroid camera. Oh, gosh, it was good. That was amazing. And then after they had done that thing, we piled into the fair lane, and we'd go off to church. Now, that was how we celebrated Easter. And I'll tell you, every single Easter, that's what I remember. But you know, this whole business about remembering stuff, well, that seems really appropriate this morning. Because according to the passage we just read from Luke, isn't that what those two guys in the tomb told the women to do? I mean, they didn't tell the women to not be afraid. Didn't do that. Didn't tell the women to go and tell others. Didn't tell them to do that. Instead, after asking, why are you looking in the place of the dead for someone who's alive? Jesus isn't here. He's been raised from death. They said, remember. Remember that while he was still in Galilee, he told you, the Son of Man will be handed over to sinners who will nail him to a cross, but 3 days later he will rise to life. You see, that was the only command those two guys gave the women. That was the only one. They told them to remember. And you know what's really interesting? That's exactly what the women did, isn't it? According to Luke, then they remembered what Jesus had said. But it didn't stop there, right? I want you to notice that the remembering itself changed those women. Those women were changed by remembering. I mean, even though they hadn't been told to go anywhere or to tell anyone, once those women started to think about what Jesus had said and what Jesus had done, and maybe even what Jesus had called them to do, what's the first thing they did? What's the first thing those women did? Just listen to what Luke wrote. Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and some other women who were the ones who had gone to the tomb. When they returned, they told the 11 apostles and the others what had happened. You see, on their own, after they had remembered, those women went and those women told. And even though most of the disciples thought their words were a lot of baloney, Peter responded, didn't he? In fact, he got so excited that he got up and ran to the tomb just to check it out. You see, those women changed when they remembered. And I'll tell you, the exact same thing can happen to us. If we also do what those two young men told the women to do in that tomb. And let me explain exactly how we can do it. Exactly how we can do it. You see, first, we can remember some of the things Jesus taught when he was right here on earth. For example, when we are down, you ever get down? You ever feel down? And whenever we feel as though if life is a rat race, the rats are winning, whenever we feel like that, we can remember that Jesus said, "The Lord's Spirit has come to me because he has chosen me to tell the good news to the poor. The Lord has sent me to announce freedom for prisoners, to give sight to the blind, to free everyone who suffers, and to say, this is the year the Lord has chosen." We can remember. And when we start to wonder if God has forgotten us and the divine justice is just a lot of words, we can remember that according to Jesus, God will bless you people who are poor. His kingdom belongs to you. God will bless you hungry people. You will have plenty to eat. God will bless you people who are crying now. You will laugh. And I'll tell you, we can remember. And I'll tell you, when we feel there is no way that we can be loved by God, there's absolutely no way because we have done too much, hurt too many folks, made too many mistakes, we're never going to be good enough. I think we can remember that when the crowds ask, "How can anyone ever be saved?" Jesus replied, "There are some things that people cannot do, but God can do anything." You see, these are some of the things Jesus taught, and these are some of the things we can remember, and that's one. But that's not all. Second, I think we can also remember what he did. And I want you to think about that. What are some of the things that Jesus showed during his life? What are some of the qualities he showed? Well, he certainly showed power, didn't he? I mean, when he stilled the storm and when he kicked out demons and he showed courage. I mean, this guy stood toe-to-toe with the movers and shakers of his society. And he confronted those religious leaders who used God and God's word to sort of browbeat and to club the people. But most important of all, I think Jesus showed what? Love. Jesus showed love. And although his love wasn't limited to one group of people, like it excluded others or just to one, he seemed to make sure that those folks who were usually ignored and condemned by their society, he made sure that they knew that they weren't alone. Now that's what he did.
And you know, that power and that courage and certainly that love sort of came together with the cross and the empty tomb. I mean, like I've said before, I have a hard time understanding how Jesus would allow himself, I want you to think about this, how Jesus would allow himself to be nailed to a cross to save the people who drove the nails. And just think about the empty tomb. Man, it means that God has the power over death itself, the ultimate thing we fear, right? And that Jesus had the courage to face his fate with faith, and that he loved you and me so much that he gave us a concrete sign of hope. And that sign of hope is an empty tomb. You see, because his tomb was empty, we can be sure that one day, so will ours. I'll tell you, that's what Jesus did. And this is something else we can remember. And that's two. And then third, we can remember what we've been called to do. And although, I'm gonna let you in on a secret. Aren't you glad you came this Easter morning? Because I'm going to let you in on a secret. This business about what to do, man, it's made overly complicated by minister types like me, even if they're not wearing seersucker suits. I'm going to let you in on a secret. It is really, really easy. What God wants us to do, it is really easy. It is not rocket science. In fact, everything we've been called to do can be reduced to one word. One word. Everything. One word. And what's the word? Love. That's the word, love. The scriptures say, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. They also say, love your neighbors as much as you love yourself. Man, that's it. What does God want us to do? That's it. Man, I told you it was simple. But I want you to just imagine how that simple command can change our lives. I mean, what do you think would happen if every single day we woke up in the morning and the first thing, not the first thing, maybe the second or third thing, that we thought about was, how can I show love to God? How can I show love to God today? How can I show love to God by what I say and by what I do? How can I do that? What do you think, what kind of day do you think we would have if that was something we thought of right at the beginning? And then I want you to imagine what would happen as we walked into our offices or into our classrooms. And we said to ourselves, how am I going to show my love for my neighbor? How can I show the kind of love to him that I'd like to receive myself? Man, if we said that and if we meant it, guys and ladies, are we going to share gossip about our bosses? Are we going to do that? If that's what we decide to do? Are we going to join with other people that may be in the class and make fun of, you know, the guy that nobody seems to like? Are we going to do that? Man, are we going to do those kind of things if we've decided to love our neighbor as ourselves? I don't think so. Instead, I think it's a better than even chance that not only are we not going to be gossiping about somebody, but we might also be willing to give the guy, you know, the benefit of the doubt before casting judgment. And who knows, we may even befriend, or at the very least, treat that person who's always on the fringe. And you know who I'm talking about. The person always on the fringe, we're going to treat them with as much respect and as much kindness as we'd like to be treated ourselves. My gosh. If we did that kind of thing, and if we did it consistently, I think God could use us to change our offices and to change our schools and to change our communities. And my gosh, He could use us to change the world. But then that's just what God has called us to do. And that's something else we can remember. You know, Easter is always going to be a time for memories. I mean, it's tailor-made for us to remember when we were younger, my gosh. And I sincerely hope that when Maggie, and you don't know it, but that's me right there. No. I had a different childhood. I sincerely think, or at least hope, that when Maggie is my age, 39, that when she looks back on Easter, she'll have all kinds of memories. Of course, you got to understand, in our family, at least for me, Easter was what? A work day. Easter was a working day. Therefore, I probably wasn't around as much as my dad was on Easter morning. But be that as it may, she's still going to remember. And I'll tell you, as this passage reminds us, we can do the same thing as we move from Easter. You see, just like the men at the tomb commanded the women, right here and now, I think we can remember. We can remember what Jesus taught. And we can remember what Jesus did. And man, we can remember what Jesus has called us to do. And I'll tell you, if we do, man, if we do what those women did, who knows? We might even be changed too. Amen. Let's have a word of prayer together. Almighty God, inspire us now that we might claim this opportunity. And it's really, really easy. You've just called us to remember. So let's remember what you said. And let's remember what you did. And let's remember what you've called us to do. And then, Lord, give us the insight and give us the strength and give us the willingness to get up and do it. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, on this Easter morning, we've got the opportunity, a unique opportunity, to share in the presence of the resurrected, in the resurrected Christ in a special way. Now, this is called the Lord's table, because on the table are elements that Jesus used when he shared a last meal with his disciples. And this table represents for us something incredibly special. Although physically he's not here, spiritually Jesus is present. And when we gather around this table, we are enjoying and celebrating his presence in a very, very special way. In fact, Jesus said that when he comes in his kingdom, when he comes in power, people are going to come from north and south, east and west, and share with him in paradise. So for all of you who see meaning in the bread and in the cup, gather around the Lord's table, and let's share in his presence. Let's have a word of prayer together. Almighty God, you are present with us because you are with us always. But right now, we're about to enjoy your presence in a very, very special way. You are the host of this meal, and we appreciate it. And as we approach this table, we remember. We remember. We remember, Lord God, the loyalty you had to your people. My goodness gracious, even though your people wandered around and did their own thing and didn't seem to care about you, you never abandoned them. They never ceased to be yours. You never stopped being present with them as they moved into the future. That kind of constancy we remember and we celebrate today. And as we think about
Your son, Jesus Christ, whose resurrection we celebrate today. Oh, there's so much to remember. How he lived and he taught, and by his life and through his words, we end up understanding how we might live. And then on the cross, since we died with him, the power of sin was broken. And through that resurrection, we can see our future, and that future is going to be a resurrection for us all. Our future is going to be glorious. And for that kind of love, we celebrate you. And Lord God, we are here because of your Holy Spirit that surrounds us now. That Spirit that opens our eyes and our ears so that we can see and hear. That opens our minds so that we can understand. And opens our hearts so that we can feel. But maybe most importantly, that opens our hands so that we can give. Lord God, we appreciate that constant presence made known by your Holy Spirit. And so, Lord, as we gather around this table and as we celebrate your presence in this special way, help us to remember who you are. Who you are. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, after he shared a simple meal with his disciples, he took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is the my body given for you." And in the same way, after they had shared the bread, he took the cup, and into the cup he poured the wine. And he said to them, "This cup represents the new covenant sealed by my blood. As often as you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you remember my death until I come again. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, grant us your peace." Remember, the body of Christ was given for you. Remember, the blood of Christ was shed for you. Almighty God, as we leave this place and go about the rest of our day, help us carry the presence of Christ with us. Help us to be the kind of people that other folks can see as being a little different. Maybe a little happier, certainly a little kinder, a little more patient. Help us to display the love of Jesus Christ outside these walls, so that through us people may get to know. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Let's all stand up and let's close the service by singing Rejoice, the Lord is King.
Oh.
Just out of curiosity, how many of y'all are having some special dinner at home? Somebody's home. Okay. You're having special dinner? Well, that's good. Trust me, you'll still make it home before the ham finishes cooking. No, Jake, we won't do that. Hey, y'all who have streamed in, I am delighted you were with us this morning to celebrate Easter. Thank you very, very much for joining us in this wonderful occasion. And y'all who are visiting from out of town, have a safe trip back. Y'all who are closer in town, we worship next Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. And you see, we have plenty of pews available. So I invite you to come and join us next week for worship. And for everybody, go now. Oh, one other thing I need to mention. If you haven't made an offering already, there's a plate in the back of the sanctuary. You can feel free to leave your offering back there. Brothers and sisters, go now in peace. And be challenged on this Easter, be challenged to remember. Remember what Jesus taught. Remember what Jesus did. And remember what we've been called to do. And to inspire this walk, receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people of God said,
Amen.
Amen.